It's beginning to look familiar to me. After several years.
Yeah, it was 6 years since you've been here before. Mm-hmm.
This is an especially beautiful morning to be arriving here.
And the thing with Bengt Lidström is that he takes care of the whole environment, not just the houses, also the fields and the trees and how it looks of it, and so it's a good farm to work at and live at. And here you can see his lake. It's called the Butter Lake, actually, Swedish Smörsjön. He found a very beautiful place.
Feels so peaceful.
And he rented this place the first 30 years he lived here. He came to this place 1947, and then he started to, you know, cut out woods and build buildings, and had this house as a summer cottage till he retired 1981. Down there he has his boathouse.
Uh-huh.
He actually built that in the late 60s on his vacation. Hmm. And then over here he has his outdoor workshop,
mm-hmm.
his summer workshop, where he loves to work in the light and with the birds and the growing things around him. Mm-hmm. And then here he has his cold workshop, where he has his planer and his bandsaw and his drill press. The rough and out workshop. His equipment are quite old, actually. The bandsaw is huge. Kunna prata lite grann om den här vackra fågelskålen och se va?
Ja, den är ju nu i huvudsak...
It's finished on the outside, in its shape, and now it's the inside that is left.
Nästa fas är ju då att skära rent här och...
Fårorna där, ja.
Ja.
And then the, after finishing the inside, the next stage is to carve these staves here. And to make the design of this ship carving on the outside, and then to cut these gouge marks.
Ja, de här svängda skålarna, som jag säger, de får ju sin form av...
He says that this shape has been given its design by itself because it stops the hollowing from the outside of the log. You can see the growth rings in here, how it follows the curve on the outside. And he was the first one actually who started this way back in the 60s. And he found out that it helped him in the design of the holes.
So traditionally the log was oriented the other way for the ball.
Så frågan är alltså, traditionellt så var, såg den ut på ett annat sätt, eftersom då var...
Och den får ju sin form av halvklorens utsida. Utsida.
Mm. He says that this is the traditional way, of course, with the pith and the inside up here. And then it's given its shape from the outside by the log, like that. And the only thing that you can decide is how long it's going to be.
Having already demonstrated the bandsaw shaping of a bowl from a blank oriented bark side up, Lidstrom is now taking this blank to his machine shop for work on a bowl bark side down. This video will continue to follow the two different styles of bowl through the rest of the shaping and decorating procedures, picking up and leaving off with a number of different projects.
Spelet kan börja. Thank you. Ja. Thank you.
He's talking about this is of course an old tradition of making patterns on old things, and he is influenced by the tradition, of course, the Norwegian, the Swedish, and the Finnish, and the Russian tradition. But he also says that this kind of cups here, he has never seen anywhere else. And Drew were pointing out that maybe it's Viking shields, like Viking shields. And he's been looking a lot into Viking ships and stuff like that. And he has this special pattern with two snakes or what it is that comes together. And this pattern is very common in the very north of Sweden.
In Viking art.
Yeah, and very much influenced from Finland and Russia and in Viking art. He also points out influences from just ship carving on furniture. And I can see, you know, influences from Greece, old Greece. Mm-hmm. Antique patterns, like we call this is the egg, and we call this the stave. So it's the symbols of life and death, life and death. Mm. Very old patterns. Now he is gouging out these small bowls here to be finished, and then he's going to make a pattern like this on this side here. And then after that he's going to make some rifles or ribs here in the bottom like this. And then he will finish up with the bottom here, make it smooth and nice. Mm. Thank you.
Ja. Thank you.
usually he thin and up this artist oil color, with just with turpentine, no oil. Because he says the artist oil color is so fat, so you need to thin it.
It's already full of oil.
Yeah, so you need to thinning it out.
Uh-huh. Does he sometimes paint it a couple of times?
Målar det flera gånger. Utom grundningen. Just one time,
one cup.
If you don't count the grounding,
of course, yeah.
Which is the first part, actually. Yeah, titanium white is don't dry so fast, but it covers the surface very good. Uh-huh. But zinc white dries faster, but don't cover it good. So therefore, you mix these two together, so you get the good out of both.
Yeah.
Does he ever use the white as a solid color, or is it always just a ground?
Jag frågade om de använde vit som färg någon gång, så han har den som färdig färg, den vita.
Men del i...
Yes, he says, as parts inlays like that, he can have it, but not on these parts or outside parts. Kan vi hålla upp dem så här, i ljuset så, and hold them together.
Will it be identical?
Likadant som den?
Ja, jag har inte tänkt så långt, men det är ju möjligt.
Ja, he hasn't been thinking that far, but maybe, he says.
Is it carved the same?
Så ser jag, tittar vi på.
Not quite. It's
different. He's grounded it in white, so the white sticks through a little.
Yeah.
And so does the wood grain, too.
Yeah. And especially with blue color, you have to do that, because otherwise the blue color gets green, because the wood is yellow. Mm-hmm. It's necessary.
Ja, så där exempelvis.